Well, good afternoon. Good, still morning. Good morning. Got morning for 20 more minutes. That's awesome. Good morning. It's just good to see you. Danny sent something to me a week or two ago. This is the final word on nutrition and health. So remember, you heard it here. Benny's not here, so I can give you the final word. This is what you won't hear in our health seminar. This is the final word. The Japanese eat very little fat and suffer fewer heart attacks than the English. The Mexicans eat a lot of fat and suffer fewer heart attacks than the English. The Chinese drink very little red wine and suffer fewer heart attacks than the English. The Italians drink a lot of red wine and suffer fewer heart attacks than the English. The Germans drink a lot of beer, eat a lot of sausages and fats, and suffer fewer heart attacks than the English. Conclusion: eat and drink what you like. Speaking English is apparently what kills you. That's funny. That is funny. I just got back from Hong Kong and Taiwan, and it was a wonderful time, always wonderful. I had a couple days to be with Jackie Pullinger, who's a real hero of the faith, one of the most incredible women alive, no doubt. And that was wonderful. We're going to strengthen our connection there and bring her out here at some point. And Dennis Balcom as well, who there are millions of believers in China as a direct result of his ministry. And actually, before Toronto broke out, the exact same stuff was breaking out in China under Dennis's ministry, which is real fun to hear and to see. Anyway, we'll be strengthening that connection as well. I'll be going with him into China, hopefully this next year. But I went to Taiwan, and the only reason I don't usually give you updates on everywhere we go, because that would be all week long. We don't want to do that, but something happened in Taiwan this last Thursday night. It was the final meeting of the conference. It was my turn to speak, I stood up to speak. I said, let's just stand and give the Lord praise. Well, we did, and it was 30 to 40 minutes later, no song, nothing. There was this glory, this presence that just began to permeate. There was this thunderous response in praise that was sustained, that wasn't, it wasn't supported with music, it wasn't supported with exhortation, it was just this spontaneous lighting of a match into a gas pit, and it just blew up. And what happened in the following half hour, I suppose, is really quite remarkable, because the presence, the glory was so strong, I actually had to hold myself up behind the pulpit. Internally, I was shaking, just vibrating with this presence. It just, you know, it just filled the room. And I've only had that happen two other times that I recall. And what was so remarkable is that you could just call out something like, the Lord is opening deaf ears right now, right ears opening right now, instantly. Deaf for 37 years, ear opens. Deaf for 18 years, ear opens. Just all over the room, things of that nature. You know, it's like he sent his word and healed, and there was such presence and glory. And it actually, in a unique way, is kind of connected to what I'm going to talk to you about this morning in a few minutes. I want to show you a video first, and we're going to take a little prayer direction first. But I want to sow some seeds of thought into your heart once again, that really it is all about our privilege of living in the glory. We were designed, created, wired for interaction with the glory of God. And to see what happened, I've been homesick since Thursday night. It's the weirdest feeling. I want back in that that I saw the Lord do. Not because of an experience, although he's to be experienced. It's not the goosebump and the shaking and the falling on the ground. It's the encounter with the Almighty God. And to see so many people's lives transformed in moments because the presence was so weighty. And I from what we've had happen here in the last year and a half, I just felt like I was just to announce to you, you know, he's here, but he's coming. It's that, the fact we they sang it in a prophetic song this morning about the veil of his, the robe filling the temple in that passage in Isaiah 6. I see the Lord is high lifted up, his train fills the temple. The word fills there means it's filled it, but it's still coming. It's another, it's constantly filling. So it's like he's here, but there's more of him on the way. And Thursday night, it was like he kept cramming more of himself into the room. And that's all I'm saying is, come on, cram more of yourself into the room. Yeah, that's right. So yay God for that. All right. I want to show you a quick video. Randy Clark was here, did a healing school a couple weeks ago. And we had so many extraordinary things happen. But there was one testimony I wanted to play a little video of. And then we're going to pray together. Let's see how I'm doing for time. Then we're going to pray together for a specific miracle. I believe the video is going to release a testimony throughout our city, not only for those represented in this room that suffer with this issue, but through our city. Watch the video, and then we'll pray together.
And one of the huge things that we're facing as a country is so many veterans coming back with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder.
Well, Monday night when Mr. Clark was handing out the books, he had handed out a book on identity, and that's why I had to get to him. I made my way up here. The crowds parted like the Red Sea, because I didn't know how I was getting here. And I asked him the title of the book, and he told me, and he said, well, why do you need it? I said, I lost my identity quite a few wars ago, and I was trying to find myself. And he said, you don't need that book. Let me call up a team member to pray for you. But what was even better was that I think, I don't know, I'm speaking on your behalf, but I feel that he sensed that if he left me to wait for the team member, I was bolting for the door. Because I was scared, I was terrified, I was getting surrounded by the crowds, I was nervous, I wanted to get out of here, I was looking for a threat. But he didn't let me go, he took his mic off and he sat with me. Can't thank you enough for doing that for me. I didn't come here to get prayer for PTSD. I've come here because I've been living with chronic nerve pain in my arms and legs for the last five plus years now, until tonight. So I'm thinking, why do I have to deal with this PTSD? I came here for my nerve pain. God, what is going on? I want this pain out of my body, because it's like cutting yourself with razor blades, having acid poured on your skin and your bones crushed 24/7. You can't breathe. I couldn't play with my kids. I couldn't be with my wife. I lost my love of music because the sound and the vibration was so intense. I have to sit at the back of the church or by the exit. I couldn't stand bright lights, so my senses kind of got dulled.
All that's gone.
Mike came and prayed for me, and he held onto my wrist, and I started to panic because I did not want to be restrained. I don't think I could take Mike. He's a big guy, but I think I could take him, even in my weakened state. But what Mike did for me and what Jesus did through Mike to me was he made me look at his eyes, and he wouldn't let me put my head down. And I kept wanting to put my head down. I didn't realize the guilt and the shame I was carrying from the horrific and horrible events that I cannot even put into words, nor do I want to, because I don't see those images anymore and I don't feel that pain. Monday night, I got prayer from Mike, and as he was praying for me, I was crying, I was sweating, and I kept putting my head down. He said, look at my face. I said, don't tell me what to do. He's like, I'm not letting you go until you look at me. And so he just kind of walked me through the stages, and I can't even tell you what all of them were, but it was a short prayer. It was only 5 minutes. It wasn't nothing deep, but it was like Jesus was touching my hand, and he was speaking to me, and I felt a peace that I haven't felt since I was probably a young child. And I walked in the door of my house Monday night, and I kind of floated in the house, I guess. And my wife said to me, she said, babe, what happened? I said, I'm free. I'm free.
Let's stand and praise the Lord for faith.
My wife told me, she said, "Babe, it looks like you've lost 2,000 pounds off your shoulders, and I don't know who you are," because she's only lived with me since I've had this PTSD. She's lived through the nightmares. She's lived through being attacked in my sleep. She's lived in fear. My kids have dealt with it. She's lived through all the medication. But since then, in the last 2 days, I've played with my kids. I've held them. I've hugged them. I haven't been afraid of what's on TV, what's outside. And even better, before I came here tonight, I just got to say this. I was still having the pain in my wrist, but I said, "God, you've been so good. You've already brought me through. You got me out of bed. You got me out of the wheelchair. You got me off all these medications and narcotics." And tonight, when I go there, it's going to be done. And I don't need prayer, because I'm just going there to glorify what you did for me. As I was sitting in the lobby over there, at 6:05, I was sitting there waiting for them to open the doors. And all of a sudden, I felt my left hand. And I looked down, and I was like, "Hand? You're back." And nobody prayed for me. There was no worship going on. I got on the phone and I called my wife and I said, "Thank you, Jesus. Not only am I at peace, I have no more pain. I can touch my hands. I can clap my hands. I can feel my fingers. I can dance. And the music didn't hurt me. The lights don't hurt me. The devil's alive. Jesus came in. Father God is so great. He brought me home. My Father in heaven, thank you for bringing me home.
Come on. Wow. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I know there are folks in the room that struggle with PTSD, and there are many family members represented by others in this room. If you have a family member with that issue, or you suffer with it yourself, I believe this is the season for not only for the healing of the people in the room. I feel like the Lord wants to release something over this city to set people free. If that's your issue or a family member, stand, because we're going to pray for you right now. Those who are watching online, this miracle is available for you too. It's available right now, absolutely right now. The testimony is prophetic. It prophesies God's intent in every situation. His process varies, but the outcome is the same. Freedom. Freedom is for everyone. Church, gather around these folks. We're going to take just a couple minutes, but I want you to find out if it's them or if it's a family member, and just begin to pray, release the Word of God, release Scripture, release promise. God has given us power, love, and a sound mind, and just release that, declare that over them. Yeah, find out who it is, and then lift your voices. I want us to pray and contend together for their breakthrough. Take about 2 minutes for this, then we'll move on. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We just loose a spirit of restoration over these households right now. We release even angelic hosts where they would carry out that assignment to restore the brokenness that exists in people's hearts because of trauma and tragedy. We stand together in Jesus' name and rebuke the spirit of trauma. Loose people's hearts and minds. We call for restoration to come in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus. Let everything be restored plus interest to everyone who has suffered loss. We pray this in Jesus' name. Now just bless them in the name of the Lord. Give them a hug. Share Scripture with them. Do something. And then go ahead and find your seats, if you would. Yeah, bless them. We just bless you in the name of the Lord. I wanted to show this video for a lot of reasons, I guess. Mainly just to encourage you with what we see the Lord doing. But I feel like the Lord wants to raise up an army of believing believers to touch people that would never come here, that suffer throughout our city, suffer with this stuff. And I feel like the Lord wants to restore and heal broken people. Obviously, that's a no-brainer. But specifically, we have friends and relatives, associates that really struggle, can't leave the house, whatever it might be, because of this. Jesus heals that. He knows just how to touch that part of a broken life and bring restoration. It's not through 20 years of counseling. It's his new one-step program. It's new, and it's been going on for 2,000 years. It's brand new. All right, take your Bibles, open to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 9. I talked just a few minutes ago before the video about this this encounter with the glory. I want to talk to you about, oh goodness, I want to talk to you about the ascended life. And it's a much bigger topic than I can cover well with the time I have today. But we will get into the Word, and I'm going to give you some things that may appear to be a little abstract. Just be patient with me, and we'll try to unravel them. In Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, the Lord speaks to John the Revelator and with this statement. He says, come up higher. Come up here. And I feel like the Lord has before you and before me a constant invitation to come up higher. Here's the deal. Jesus makes a statement in John 3. And he's talking to his disciples. He's talking to Nicodemus and whoever's around in the crowd. And he makes a really bizarre statement. He says, no one, now remember, this is early in his earthly ministry, all right? He says, no one has ascended to heaven except the Son of Man who came down from heaven, who is in heaven. He's in his earthly body, standing on planet Earth, has not died, has not resurrected, has not ascended, has not been glorified. He is standing on the planet in front of a crowd, and he makes this claim, nobody has ascended except for me. And he is announcing to people that he ascends, even though in human form, ascends into heavenly realms, encountering the Father. Now, does that mean his body left the earth? I doubt it, but I don't know, and it doesn't matter to me. The point is that the Lord has called us to ascend into heavenly realms, encountering the Lord, and that is the normal Christian life. The normal Christian life is learning to live in realms of glory and learning to navigate realms of glory where they have full and complete impact on how we think and how we see. I grew up as a believer thinking that the way we were to live is that we are on earth and we persuade God to invade and fix stuff that's going wrong here. What I have since discovered is that we don't live on earth. We are seated in heavenly places, and we're to live from the realm of God's glory towards earth. Now, what's happened is that's become a point of theology instead of an experience, and all theology is an invitation to encounter. When the Lord reveals something to you, when a revelation of truth comes, now I'm not saying addition to Scripture, always confirmed in Scripture, all right? When the Lord reveals something, what revelation basically means is to lift a veil. So in other words, when he reveals something to you, the truth didn't get created just then. It's been around forever. All he did was remove the veil from your eyes to see what that truth is. Does that make sense? What happens, especially in Western culture, is that we love concepts so much is that we stop at the concept of truth and not realize that with the revelation comes a responsibility to pursue the anointing so that we can display the effect of that truth. All right, let me illustrate it. The church at Corinth was the church known for its liberal operation in the gifts of the Spirit. Paul needed to bring some understanding, some clarity to how they functioned. And so he writes in his first epistle to the church at Corinth, 1 Corinthians 12, and he gives a list of spiritual gifts and their function. What is he doing? By the anointing of the Spirit of God, he has given the church in Corinth a revelation on the gifts. All right, watch. He's lifting the veil on something that they didn't understand. Now, what do we have in verse 1 of chapter 14? A statement that says, pursue earnestly spiritual gifts. What gifts? The ones he just unveiled in chapter 12. What does that mean? It means that the revelation of the gift didn't release the gift. The revelation of the gift just showed what was available. The revelation of truth shows what's available. And with revelation is the invitation to pursue for personal encounter. And the problem is we see truth, but we fail to get into the secret place looking for the anointing to where you and I can display that truth. That's why such a large part of the body of Christ believes in the truth of healing, for example, but can't demonstrate it. If those who believed in healing could demonstrate it, we would no longer have part of the church that didn't believe in healing. The big testimony against us is that we have concepts that we believe in that we can't demonstrate. This is where truth carries with it an automatic responsibility to pursue earnestly. Now, that passage, he does say, pursue earnestly spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. I personally don't believe Paul was exalting prophecy above the other gifts. The context was that which is needed for edification of the body of Christ, the prophetic is the greatest. Two things. Number one, the pursuit of the gift that is most needed in that situation. Guess what? If somebody is dying of a disease, the prophetic might encourage them, but what you really need is a miracle. You might want to pursue that one. All right. Secondly, 14:1 tells us, pursue earnestly spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy, that you can be specific in your pursuit. It's not just, oh God, whatever your will is. Listen, if you pray whatever your will is, you pray general prayers, you get general answers. All right, that's enough of that. So here's the deal. The Lord has created this realm of glory. All have sinned, fallen short of the glory. So sin caused us to fall short of his intent for humanity, that is, living in the glory. You are wired for the glory. You are designed for the glory. Even Old Testament worshipers spent so much time in the glory that they were able to confess, my heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. They had spent so much time in the manifest presence of the Lord that their physical appetites were recalibrated to hunger for what they were designed to hunger for. I want to read to you a passage out of John 7 before we actually get into Luke 9, all right? Verse 37 of John 7, on the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Okay, now work with me on this, because I want to make sure that you catch this, because this will set us up for Luke 9. He says, out of your heart will flow rivers. So he's giving a metaphor, he's giving a picture. Out of your heart will flow rivers of living water. And then he says, but this he was speaking of concerning the Spirit. The Spirit being what? The Spirit being the river. He was speaking of the Spirit who was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. Now, growing up, I was wondering, you know, the disciples did so many weird things like arguing as to who's the greatest and, you know, rebuking Jesus when he said he was going to die and just fun stuff like that. They just made some real huge mistakes. And so I grew up wondering, why didn't you give them the Holy Spirit while you were with them? I mean, they really could have used the help. And it tells us here why. It says, because he wasn't yet glorified. So then what does that mean? That means that the release of the Spirit of God upon you is actually connected to Jesus' position of being glorified. There's a connection between the Spirit of God on you and Jesus being glorified. So now we have to look at that. What is the Holy Spirit given for? So we find every verse. We find that He is our comforter. He teaches us. He guides us. He convicts. He does all these things. He opens up. He gives revelation. There's all these things that the Spirit of God does. But everything on that list has one conclusion. It all has one aim, one target. Everything He does is to make us like Jesus. Everything. So, if the Holy Spirit could not be given until Jesus was glorified, then it stands to reason that if the Holy Spirit had been given while Jesus was in His earthly ministry, then the Holy Spirit would have been conforming the disciples into the image of the Jesus headed to the cross and not the Jesus resurrected, ascended, and glorified. Now, the weight of Scripture affirms that concept. John the Revelator, if you can picture the Passover Supper, he's got his head on the chest of Jesus. He's announced he's going to die. They don't know how to sort this stuff out. Everybody's wanting to know, am I the one that's going to betray you? So there's this moment of sorrow, of confusion, all this stuff. This John, who beholds this Jesus, who is about to die, sees him later in Revelation chapter 1. In Revelation chapter 1, he is described as eyes of fire, hair white like wool, feet of burnished bronze. Here's this bizarre description of Jesus that is completely different than what John saw at the Passover meal. That John wrote in 1 John 4:17 these words, "As He is, so are we in this world." As He is, resurrected, ascended, glorified. In that position, so are we in this world. These scriptures reveal intent. These scriptures reveal the weight of what already exists in our Holy Spirit account. One of the cornerstones of my own thinking and belief system for the last 40 years has been that Jesus is returning for a glorious church. It's at the heart and soul of what I live for and believe for. I have a hard time believing that He would go through everything He did to come back to take home a jigsaw puzzle that He has to piece together and bring healing to because it's so fragmented. Jesus is returning for a bride whose body is in equal proportion to her head. So, now go to Luke 9. If I lost you on the last one, it's all right. Luke 9, hopefully this will make more sense. Luke 9, verse 27. What we're going to do is we're going to look at the story of the Mount of Transfiguration. This story is recorded in three Gospels, what's called the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Each time the story is covered in these Gospels, there is a preceding verse that sets it up, but at least at first glance for me, it looks like it's unrelated. And yet, the Holy Spirit made sure that this verse, this statement, preceded each time the story of the Mount of Transfiguration was mentioned. Here's the verses. Matthew 16, it says this, "Truly I say to you, there are some of those who are standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man come in His kingdom." Mark 9 says, "Jesus was saying to them, truly I say to you, there are some of those who are standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God after it has come with power." Luke's Gospel, verse 27. "But I tell you truly, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God." This statement, not taste death until they see the Son of Man, the kingdom in power, the kingdom. This statement preceded this bizarre, extreme experience that took place on the Mount of Transfiguration. Here's the deal. The very next verse, verse 28, he says, it came to pass about 8 days after these sayings, he took Peter, John, and James and went up on the mountain to pray. Okay, here's the point I want to make as we get started on the story. All right. He says, there are some of you standing here who won't taste of death until you see this kingdom of God come with power, the Son of Man come with power. All right. 8 days later is the Mount Transfiguration. What I'd like to suggest to you is that the Mount of Transfiguration is not what he was prophesying about, but it was the prototype of what he was prophesying about. It's pointless to stand before a crowd and say, there are some of you standing here that will still be alive in 8 days. He's announcing something that's down the road. But why 8 days later, in every time it's recorded, was the Mount of Transfiguration? Because there was something that took place in the Mount of Transfiguration that was a prototype, a prophetic picture of the kingdom coming and what it was supposed to look like. There is a connection between the two. Are you with me on that? There's a connection between the two. So that's what I'm going to look at. All right. Verse 29. As he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered and his robe became white and glistening. As he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered. This is an interesting phrase. The appearance of his face was altered. I think it's New American Standard says it was different. The word is other. So as he is standing before them, his face became other. It became a different face. Do you remember the road to Emmaus after the resurrection? A couple of the disciples are walking with Jesus, but they don't know it's him. Why? Because he looks different. And what the Lord is doing, what the Lord is doing is he's making a connection. Look up here. He's making a connection between recognizing him through presence and not just through manifestation. It's important to know when you come into the presence whose presence it is. Because sometimes he is other. And it's still important to recognize him. It goes on and it says, not only was his face altered, his robe became white and glistening. That word for glistening, gleaming, is another translation. It is actually a word that means like lightning flashes. We're not talking about bright white clothing. We're talking about living lightning flashes. I mean, that's a shirt right there. Lightning is brighter than the sun. It's hotter than the sun. We're talking about absolute brilliance in a garment. I mean, you can imagine how terrified the disciples are. First of all, they watched him. He's got a different face. He's other. And now his clothes are alive. And they're like lightning. No wonder Peter tried to think of something to do. Let's build tabernacle. You know, when you're insecure, and all of us are in some measure, the glory brings it out, and you try to find something else to do. So here is a visual picture of transformation or transfiguration. Here's an interesting thought. Jesus was transfigured before them. That's the picture of it. It's the same basic word used in Romans 12 to describe the renewing of our mind. I would like to suggest to you that that picture of the transfigured Jesus is in the physical what a renewed mind looks like in the invisible. It is altogether brilliant. (Clears throat) Verse 30 says, "Behold, two men talked with him, Moses and Elijah, and they appeared in glory." Appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Sometimes we get in trouble for things like this that happen. I'm not saying that you should try to talk to Moses or Elijah or anyone else who's already dead. So just write a note down. Bill's not saying talk to the dead. What I am saying is, in the glory, there's a very thin veil between those two worlds. And Jesus is the prototype of a glorious people in this moment. This moment is the imagery of a people that become glorious in the presence. The effect, the effects, the impact of who you are and what you carry on your surroundings. Elijah and Moses, why those two? We know that John the Baptist, it was said of him that he came in the spirit and power of Elijah. Elijah was known for power. Moses was known for authority. Those are the two realms that Jesus released over his disciples. So these two are the high point before Jesus. They are the high points in Israel's history in the realms of power and authority. They are the two realms that will be essential for the next thing that God is doing in the earth. This time, not just power or authority on two special people, but now this that's taking place on this mountaintop is the actual prophetic prototype of what will happen in every believer that comes in the glory, lives with power and authority to affect and to bring about change. What happened previous to Jesus with Moses and Elijah, as glorious as it was for its day, it was not sufficient enough for the last days. And so Jesus is now talking with Elijah and Moses. And it says they came to talk to him about his death, about his demise. This is strange. In the wilderness, when Jesus fasted 40 days, after that 40-day fast, and he faced the temptation, the encounter with the devil, the Bible says, and the Father sent angels to comfort him. In the garden, as he sweat his drops of blood and is preparing to be crucified and for the only time in all of eternity to become separate from the Father, in that moment, the Father sends angels to comfort him. But in this moment, he sends two veterans. These are the only two, the righteous two, that God killed in the Old Testament. Sounds brutal. When he was done, they were dead. And now they are coming to talk with Jesus. We don't know what they discussed or what was shared, but we do know they came to talk about his death. They had experience in dying at the hand of God. Jesus was about to become sin. He was about to become the most despised thing in existence. The Father would actually turn his back upon his own Son. He poured out the wrath of God upon his Son as his Son became sin to destroy the power of sin, so that you and I might become the righteousness of Christ. Moses and Elijah come to talk to him about that death. This picture of the Mount of Transfiguration is a one-time experience in Jesus' life that I believe will become more and more common in the life of the church. I don't mean that our clothes turn into lightning and we get different faces, you know. But there's a realm of glory represented there. Moses and Elijah showed up in the glory to talk with Jesus. There's something timeless about the glory that God is wanting to recalibrate the hearts of people. A few weeks ago, I spoke to you about Psalm 73, that kind of that bizarre psalm of Asaph, who served under David and then under Solomon. He served at the high point of Israel's history, and he saw the downfall through idolatry and all this stuff. He was a frustrated worshiper. And he writes in this psalm, he says, the wicked wear pride like a necklace, and it doesn't even seem to cost them. They die and they don't even have pain when they die, you know, and he's just moaning, you know, moaning and groaning. I think I'm going to eat some worms, you know, that kind of a song. And it says, and if I stop and think about it, this thing's way too painful for me until I come into the sanctuary and then I perceive their end. The sanctuary is the place of manifested presence. It's the place of glory. What's the point? Everything outside of the glory is subject to distortion. Everything outside the glory is subject to distortion, to perversion, to being misrepresented. The obligation that we have to bring a clear manifestation of this Jesus, this wonderful Lamb of God, the one who became sin so that you and I could become righteous. The privilege and responsibility to manifest this one is directly connected to our passion, desire, and ability to live in the glory. It would appear to some, I'm sure, that to emphasize the glory so much is to emphasize like a sub-point. It's like to make a major out of a minor. And I don't think so. I think we're discovering how major that minor is. That it's actually the sustained, abiding presence of the Lord that is our life. It actually is our life. It's that outside of the glory, I'll try hard, but there's no guarantee I'll hit it. In the glory, I see clearly. There's something about this picture of a transfigured Jesus that is the picture of a church in glory. The Lord tests us. And I don't treat the subject of testing of the Lord like many do. I don't look at him at all as a punisher or as one who puts us in bad situations just to watch us miserably fail. It's not that at all. I remember years ago hearing the story, you know, you take a bicycle tire that has a hole in it, you fill it up with air, you put it under water, you find the hole, you patch it. You don't put it back on the bike. You fill it full of air and put it under pressure again. Why? Because you want to prove the patch worked. When the Lord, at least half the tests we are in are to prove that His work has worked. That he's done what He said. His promise has been accomplished so that we will recognize the work of grace that's been done in us. We look back and go, man, I handled that better than the last time. Yay, God. How many of you had that happen recently? You go, whew, I passed that test. Thank you, Jesus. I hope I don't ever go around that mountain again. And that's exactly it. And the Lord, what is He doing? He's testing us in different areas. But here's the big one. The big one is, how can you handle glory? How do you handle glory? Some will say, well, we have no glory. That's not true. You can't give Him glory if you don't have it. We were designed with glory. Each person, every part of creation is a measure of glory. The scripture talks about the planets, the creation itself. They all have a measure of glory. Every human being carries a measure of glory. Oh, it's supposed to be 1:15. I'm done. And I thought for sure I had 8 minutes left. We are on such a tight time thing here. I'm so sorry. I got to find a place to land. I'm at 40,000 feet. We're going to do a nosedive. I'm not going to end where we are, but we will end quickly. I am so sorry. It messes up the next group. I'm so sorry. I need help. I need somebody here who just says, Bill, you got 5 more minutes. Yeah. All right. Let me do it this way. How you handle glory, which can be the manifested presence of the Lord, it can be recognition and favor. How you handle glory will determine how much you will be useful in the next season. And I hate to end with a sobering story, but I will. The devil got caught up in his own beauty and was booted out of heaven because he couldn't handle the measure of glory he was designed for. The Lord does not want that to happen to those made in his image. If I can use that as a metaphor. So what he's doing is he exposes us to realms of presence to see, will they get nervous and run? Will they change the subject? Will they press in? Will they rest? What will they do? When I use them powerfully, how does the story go? Are they the center of the story? Do they honestly give me the credit? And it's all to position us for what I believe is the Mount Transfiguration model of a glorious church. Let's stand and we'll close with prayer. Okay, awkward landing. Didn't even have time to tell you to put up the seat, the tray tables and put on the seat belts. We just crashed that thing. It's all right. So, Lord, we do pray that you would affect, calibrate our hearts for this next season of increasing glory. And I give you praise for that. I give you thanks for that. Amen. Amen. Real quick. Some wonderful, 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 wonderful friends are here that I forgot to introduce at the beginning. Russell and Sam Evans from Planet Shaker Ministry. It's the only ministry I know that should be called Planet Shaker because that's exactly what they're doing. Why don't you guys wave and get up here on the stairs so everybody can see you. Just so at least so they can see you. These are absolute heroes of mine, absolute blessed people. I love them so much, and they surprised me this morning by showing up. And I'm glad that if I would have known they were coming, I might have had them preach. But anyway, bless them. I want ministry team to come. Sherry, are you wrapping this up? I am sorry for running this late, but like cattle, we need to get you out of this building. All right. Hold on a moment until she tells you what you've won.
Wow. I feel like I don't need to eat lunch now because I just had a full meal. Such a rich teaching today. Ministry, please come quickly up front, and we want to pray for everyone today who wants prayer. If you want prayer, you can come forward and get kind of in front here on this line, and then we have the Freedom Banner going up right here. If you want to just kind of get close to Jesus again, maybe today made you think, I need to get close to God. These guys want to pray for you. So the rest of you have a really great day as you weave down that road away from church. The rest come. So come on up if you want prayer. Ministry team, come please. You just kind of stand on that line facing forward. The team, when they're open, they'll come and find you. I actually have some ministry team members available down here. If you need prayer, just raise your hand if you're up here for prayer. Ministry team, look around, find them, please.
Glad to see you as always. I'm Lauren and this is Sherry.
Hi.
And I have some great news to start us out today.
Come on.
You might have watched a couple Sundays ago on January 7th, 27th, Bill spoke a message called Abiding in the Word, and he led us through some declarations, and we've had testimonies pouring in from people who partnered with those declarations, and I want to read a couple of them out to you. They're so amazing. Janice McManus got her car keys back after they'd been missing for months.
That's so cool.
I know. Ellie and Nigel Carmen in the UK won a small victory in court over a fraudulent property case, which is amazing. Katya found her long-lost heirloom necklace, which is fantastic.
Cool.
And Carrie Benson had a couple blessings happen to her, getting a ticket to a Women of Faith conference that she'd been wanting to go to. Things like that of all kinds. We were just so excited to hear that that message has been impactful. I would encourage you to go listen to it. It was amazing.
Oh, so good.
Yeah.
And on coming on after that testimony, we're going to go after some prayer requests. Sue, she's requesting prayer for stage 4 MATS. I don't know if it's Matt's cancer or what. But it's she needs a creative miracle in her colon, lungs, bones, and lymph nodes. Any types of cancer, we just come against a stage 4. I have a friend that's battling it. The doctors have kind of written him off. So we just come against that. Even if the doctors say there's no more hope, we just speak life and
life
healing,
and hope.
Healing and hope over you, Sue, and anyone else dealing with cancer, stage 4, and your. We just speak hope into your life and into your body.
Yeah.
Also, Beth, you would like prayer for chronic fatigue, pain, and tiredness. You've been dealing with this for the last 15 years, and it's time it stops. It stops today. Also, a sleep pattern for your young children and your husband who's in back pain. That's been a common thing that's going on even around here.
Yeah.
Sleep patterns are being broken. It's just not, it's not okay. So we're going after that, and sweet sleep in the night season so your body can be restored. Also, Karen in Virginia, that same message, heard that same message, is going after breakthrough in her inheritances.
Yeah.
She's been on crutches from a botched surgery, 5.5 years. Her leg and hip is all messed up. Her sciatic nerve was damaged. And so we speak healing to your body as well as finances for the home that your estranged brother, there's some issues with that. And we just speak healing and restoration in family and in your bodies.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name.
Yeah, I've got a couple more. We've got Hannah and Michael Ganderton in England. They're expecting a baby in May and received some bad news, a not fun diagnosis that there's extreme swelling in the baby's brain. So we just declared that as a bad diagnosis in Jesus' name. This baby is healed even before it is born. We're just declaring a healthy baby born in May. And for Susanna Brooke, you got word that you've got high blood pressure, and we don't believe that that's God's plan for you either. And so we just declare a lowering of the blood pressure and a healthy body fully aligned with the design of heaven in Jesus' name.
Awesome. Well, thank you for joining us today. It was an incredible message.
It was.
If you didn't hear all of it, download it again or whatever. It was awesome. Join us tonight at 6 o'clock. Eric Johnson's going to continue the tradition of the Johnson family, bringing it and releasing it. So join us tonight at 6 o'clock.
Yep.
We love you guys, and we'll see you then.
Bye.
Bye-bye.